And what learnings do you think we'll take from this lockdown period that will start affecting what we're doing in design?
It's been difficult to watch some of our clients who've over the last 2 or 3 years have produced really lovely workspaces, almost sabotaging them by putting Perspex screens in and you know, the tape's gone everywhere and they've kind of ripped them apart. And actually, for me, there is still a belief, I think, that this is not going to be a massive disruption to the agendas that we were following before and that will continue to be followed afterwards. So, you know, principally the ongoing need for greater balance and flexibility, you know, the not buying the death of the office noise for a second. You know, we undoubtedly there'll be less overall commercial space to service than there was previously, and companies will contract. But the need to have offices for people to go to and the need for those offices to be better than they've ever been before is absolutely paramount. If you're giving people the choices to say you can work from wherever you want, you better make sure the office is really bloody good to get them to take the time and worthwhile the travel to come in. So I still think we'll continue to pursue the agendas that were, you know, were top of our list before, which was principally was well-being, was aesthetically the ongoing kind of softening, the more hospitality influence, the domestic influence of the workplace, coupled with a more task-oriented workplace layout, you know, and I can't see that changing. You know, you when you come into the office, if you need to do individual focused work, that's where you do it. If you need to do open collaborative teamwork, that's where you do it. If you need to meet a client, that's where you do it. And that we started before, that we will undoubtedly go back to, where it's the onus is on the individual to move themselves around the space in order to put themselves in the appropriate settings for the work that needs to be done.
It's been quite funny, hasn't it, to sort of see some of that commentary about the death of the office, it's over, you know, the office is losing its preeminence, forget about it, we've all not been using it for the last 4 months, and it's human beings focusing on certainty, trying to create certainty in uncertainty, and we catastrophize, rightly so, because it's an incredible place in which we find ourselves, but we did it post 9/11. In the headlines in the end of 2001, beginning of 2002, it's the death of the skyscraper. No longer will we be building, living in, or working in tall buildings. And I could show you 45 headlines from Time magazine to The Guardian. And New York continued to plow on and build half of its tall buildings since. So we try and seek certainty. It sort of gives us a dopamine release. But we don't know, you know, we don't know. But one thing's for sure is we're not going to be not moving back into our offices.
People have got short memories as well. Like, you know, we weren't at home for very long. We only went home for 3 weeks, and then most people came back into the office, at least half of everyone came back into the office. And it doesn't take long for you to become a bit blasé about what's going on. So, you know, you published the results of the survey that you'd done last week, and the first thing I wanted to know was how many of the respondents to that survey were currently working from home. Because in our experience, it seems that those who have already gone back to work, actually it doesn't take long for them to become pretty comfortable with the situation. They just carry on almost as they were before. But those who are still slightly closeted and working from home, there is that greater level of apprehension. And that there's still that kind of that unknown and that anticipation about what they're going to be going back into.
I think that's fundamentally what it's about. It is about creating workplaces, whatever they may look like, that make people want to make that transition from home to office. So they have to be at optimum. So you have to decide, what do I need to do that I can't do at home? And what I need to do is interact with other people, like we're doing now. So that space, the built environment, has to support that interaction. As soon as that interaction is done and I have bled from that what I want, I will leave to go and do those other things I can do at home. And I think it is about, we as manufacturers and designers of product, It is about us enabling our clients to have product that makes that habit easy to adopt. So if you make something easy to adopt, if it's pleasurable, you will adopt it far quicker. So if I said to Mark, do 40 sit-ups before you have breakfast every morning, and I said to Nathan, drink a lovely cool glass of milk every morning, you can bet your life Nathan will keep on drinking the milk. Mark maybe won't want to do the sit-ups because I've made that habit pleasurable. And so you will want to embrace and hold on to that habit. I think it is now down to the organisations to create positive habits that people actively want to take on into their daily lives. And I think that's what we have to do as manufacturers and designers of product. We have to literally get, user-centred design has never been more relevant. We have to get into the shoes of that person and think, if I'm going into the office, what is it I want to have? I want the products to afford me what I know they need to. So I want to easily identify that that booth does that, that I will not be interrupted, that I won't have somebody breathing all over me. And so I think you need to, it's about clear signalling and it's about getting into the heads of the user and thinking, what would I actually want? And actually, as a consequence, then you design the product because you have the challenge, you find the solution, and you easily demonstrate the benefit.
But I guess there's some apprehension there, and also it's around convenience. Mm. It's become convenient for people to work from home, and continue to work from home and find excuses. And we, you know, for many years now, as an organisation, we've been talking about the destination office. Mm. So how do we make it attractive to employees to go to their place of work? And I guess you guys must have been talking about it as well from a design development. And yeah, come on to your point, Mark, if it's just more of the same and you're already providing different work settings, has the COVID aspect changed your design thinking and where we're gonna be in 6 months? Or do you just think organizations that may have been conservative around and conservative with a small c about adopting change, that they're more likely to adopt different work settings than just going, I'll have more desks and more task chairs?
I think that's where I am at the moment. I think that what's happened is just fueling the fire, is providing greater momentum to the agendas that actually were already started and in process. You know, clearly in physical terms, the net result of this is inevitably going to be less desks. And you know, the office is going to be used for, you know, for teams to get the best out of what they need to do on a day-to-day or week-to-week basis. So, yeah, at the moment, you know, those who've kind of who furnished their offices with Perspex screens between every desk and have replaced all those beautiful soft wall materials with cleanable vinyls and things, I think they're going to regret it pretty quickly. Because having spent now a bit of time within client premises for people who've done that, they don't feel very nice.